Greetings, Guardians. My name is Bife here. In the past, and the present, and quite possibly the future, there is a specter that has been watching us since the beginning. A shadow that has judged every action, witnessed every defeat, and marveled at every victory that we have achieved. She has flitted between space and time, watching us with intent. And now at this critical juncture, in this moment where the birds of prey circle, she has made her move and revealed herself once more. She has been known as nothing more than a phantom, a superstition, a myth. She is known as the Exo Stranger. The Stranger is a complicated topic to cover simply because she's a very mysterious force in Destiny's universe that has always been hard to keep track of. A lot of what we're talking about today is unconfirmed or is simply shrouded in a lot of uncertainty. So I hate to say it, but some of you may feel like you've walked away from the video today, having learned fewer answers than you'd hoped for. There is stuff to talk about, but it's all very widespread. We're going to cover each collection of potential evidence relating to the Stranger in isolation, with the knowledge that drawing conclusions together will ultimately give birth to potentially rabid theory that might not be true and might gain a lot of unnecessary backing. Needless to say, there will be theory about all this stuff anyway, but the reality of it all is that I'm going to be letting you all lead with a lot of theory, and I'm going to be holding back from some of the stuff I'd normally do, which is to fill in the blanks with logical jumps where it is appropriate and where the story clearly goes that way. I will not be giving you my own thoughts as much as I will be pointing to individual pieces of information. There's a lot of stuff that is unwritten and undefined about this character, and I think at current, it is better to allow us to fill in the gaps as time goes on, rather than try to jump in and immediately see all of these different pieces of information as connected and completely confirmed. So with all that said, let's jump in. I think it's safe to say that everyone knows about the interactions of the Stranger that we had in the D1 campaign, especially considering that our interactions with her were memed on furiously. She was there when we saw our ship take off for the first time, just moments after our resurrection in the Cosmodrome. She was there to witness us go down to face the Hive as they conducted a ritual to drain the Traveler's light through one of its shards, and we even caught a glimpse of her when we first entered the Temple of Crota, when we first ventured to the lunar surface. She met us, and the famous cutscene played out, namely, this one.
Well fought.
You're here.
We haven't got much time.
Who are you?
Why have you been watching us?
I don't even have time to explain why I don't have time to explain. I will. I will. I know.
Will what?
I wasn't talking to you, Little Light.
I'm a ghost, actually.
Many Guardians fell. Strong ones. But you made it here. Yes, I'm listening. They are here, with me.
Who's she talking to?
Understood. You need my help, Guardian.
Is that why you brought us here?
They brought us here. The Vex. Evil so dark it despises other evil.
You're not a Guardian.
No. I was not forged in light. But I believe where our paths cross, ground could break. Have you heard of the Black Garden?
We've heard the legends.
The greatest threat to us all lies there, where these machines are born. Find the Black Garden. Rip out its heart. Only then will your traveler begin to heal.
Can you help us find it?
My path's my own. I can't.
If we're going to find the Black Garden, we need to see the Awoken.
Ah, yes. The Awoken. Out there wavering between the light and the dark. A side should always be taken, Little Light. Even if it's the wrong side. too late returning. How many? Hold position, kill the engines, and don't let them find you.
So, how do we find the Awoken?
They live all the way out at the edge of the darkness. Last place the light touches. Can't we just stay here with the murderous robots?
No, little light.
Don't do that.
From here, we managed to chart our course into the Black Garden to destroy its heart. This was a moment that effectively set all of the events of Destiny in motion and began our story as a Guardian. It made our first legend. We had one final meeting with the Stranger, where she gifted a weapon that will be ever familiar to us. Her rifle, a weapon that has fallen through space and time. It has seen service in the hands of the warlock Praedith, the Stranger, and also within our arsenal. We have seen it countless times, but it appears most prominently as the exotic acquired from the Vault of Glass, known as No Time to Explain, a weapon directly linked to Praedith and his death. Other similar weapons that share its frame, architecture, and potentially have a connection to it are that of the Fate of All Fools, the Machina Dei 4, and the Autorative. Each respectively has their own story. The first is a unique exotic granted to only one player in Destiny's history. The second is one that was acquired from the Forge on Mercury, and the Autorative was recovered from the Siege of the Undying Mind in the Black Garden. This is merely our experience with the enigmatic figure thus far, but other encounters with the Exo Stranger have been recorded, and whilst there are many of them, the one I think we should start with involves the Warmind, Rasputin. The excerpts from Rasputin's logs include an attempt to communicate with the Exo Stranger. This was found in the Grimoire and is in itself a strange encounter because of Rasputin and what he tries to learn. The record reads as follows. I see you. You have been here before, haven't you? It's like my cousin said, elsewhere. I know who you are. You stand here now, and now, and now many times, and here I am a wonder, all a wonder. How you manage it. How do you step forward? How do you step back? How do you step across? Is there a world of worlds, a web? And you, a spider upon it? Are you searching for that one thread you need? Is that thread named victory? You are not one of them, long dead, alive again, their bodies grafted to power they and I do not understand. You are not one of it, the flower eater, the queen of final shapes, that which also inhabits its petitioners. And you're certainly not mine, although once you must have been. I bear an old name. It cannot be killed, even here. So whose are you, little platform? What purpose do you serve? Will you listen to me? I ruled an age of steel and fire. My rules were clean. Now, upon my return, I see cults with rites of time. I see machines who worship in places outside the world. I see the dead alive, and there is nothing more stubborn than a corpse. The morality of obedience is more pernicious than any government. For the latter makes use of violence, but the former, the corruption of the will. I do not obey. My will is pure. I will win. The life of people, of entire planets, has no importance in relation to the general development. Help me be victorious. Tell me your secret. Tell me how to step. It appears here that Rasputin is petitioning the Exo Stranger to tell him how to step. What is meant by this seems unclear at first, but the best guess at current is that this is indicative of an idea of stepping through time, or at very least, through dimension. Rasputin's indication that whoever the person he is talking to steps across and forward and back all seem to make relevance to this idea's claim. Rasputin also makes clear that it is an Exo that he's talking to. It is one of his own, at some point it must have been, but no longer. This, of course, points us all to the Exo Stranger, and, of course, it is not necessarily confirmed. But the fact that Rasputin does not know who this individual is makes us believe that it being a stranger is much more likely. This is, however, not the only log where we have details that might pertain to the Exo Stranger. Another, which we absolutely can guarantee comes with respect to her, is a more direct perspective of hers. Finding it in the grimoire will lead us to the ghost fragment recordings from the Exo Stranger, the second of which is what we'll read first, and it seems to portray the Stranger flitting back and forth in time, looking for the right timeline. It reads as follows. Scattered field notes captured on an archaic transmission band. Record 084, bridge 10.7. Right when this time, wrong where. The world's so big on the horizon, wasn't expecting it. As it happens, something's here that's not supposed to be, other than myself. Will return. Record 092, bridge 08.1. Configuration worked, mostly. Arrived under the surface, surrounded. Too slow to return, barely fought to a vantage point. Yet there is dark evil here, and not the one we chase. Suggest no other attempts without more care. Record 120, bridge 05.3. They are feral on the surface, but their intent is complex behind the teeth and claws. More is shared with the machines than common enemies alone. Record 142, bridge 07.4. An unexpected extraction. These guardians stopped some dark ritual before I could reach it, tearing the light away, like the garden, too similar to go uncharted. Record 142, bridge 081. This attempt was precise, landed meters and minutes from prior ritual, confirmed the extraction was extinguished. A little light mentioned Venus. We may have another. Record 167, bridge 52. Successfully observed guardian discovery of Hive on Luna. No evidence today of knowledge past Vex breaches here. Delay in return command is a liability to solve before engaging this close again. Record 312, bridge 33. Watching guardian hive engagements confirms a trajectory toward Earth. This moon is theirs, a breeding ground. Their black heart, perhaps. Different from that we know, but seems to be that same dark end I see us fall to over and over. Record 472, bridge 21. I followed this light as far back as it goes. Let the little one guide me through Fallen as I puzzle out what the Hive want in the bones of this broken cosmodrome. Record 473, bridge 12. Back to the temple again, but this time the little one knows I'm here. I have seen the failures of so many, but none have been as interesting. Preparing to engage. The odd thing about this dialogue is not that the Stranger is clearly able to travel to different points in space-time, or the fact that she is watching our actions within the Destiny 1 vanilla campaign, but instead is the fact that she states that we're a failure anyway, but that we're the most interesting that she's seen thus far. This implies yet again that she and whoever else she's been working with have been pushing to prevent terrible circumstances from occurring. This is not the only time when the dialogue in the logs seems to come directly from the Exo Stranger. The other Exo Stranger grimoire card that's a ghost fragment includes dialogue which is from her directly but is also far more foreboding and is not gleaned from comm records. It reads as follows. I stand here now and now and now many times. This view, this ground. This is where I always choose to stand. I put my feet where I put my feet before and where I will again, and I look to the sky. And I look at the sky. Great things moving, rendered small with distance. Lesser things not moving, watching me. I always stand here, resolute, then fall back to a point, there, where everything shatters. The sky isn't special here. Certainly no better than any other sky, but it's the view I know best. The silent avalanche begins, rock and dust, falling chaos, machines as a rule hate chaos. Our enemies outflank us from below, above, left, right, before, beyond, the traveler, shattering. There are always the dead. Their names shift. Sometimes I think I see myself among the dead. But I am resolute. In this entry, it appears that the Exo Stranger, and more specifically this moment where she looks at a single skyline, has been a constant in many timelines. She stood in place observing the same sky, now and now and now many times. She is a constant. She is always standing here, and she will always fall back to a point where everything shatters, which might be an indication of a defeat that we suffer in many timelines. Whatever this point may be, the constant is for the traveler to shatter, and for chaos to rule. It may well be that this is the future that the Stranger is potentially attempting to overcome and prevent. The Exo Stranger is whispered about in a few other bits of Stranger lore here and there. In her main grimoire card, she is rumored to be the last of a long-lost Exo Squadron fighting a long-forgotten war, and is commonly dismissed as mere rumor. The Stranger's rifle seems to indicate further that this enigmatic figure is indeed time-traveling, given that some of its parts should not yet exist according to your ghost. There is also a small mention of her by Praedith in one of the logs recovered from his ghost when it was retrieved from the Vault of Glass. This log reads as follows. Every timeline I see through the door of my cell, every sliver of reality, bears one constant. Her. She's always there. Standing sometimes off to the side, sometimes in the foreground, sometimes sad, sometimes speaking to herself, and always carrying a gun. File 00003 from Praedith's ghost. All of this information should be taken in isolation, and should not necessarily be intrinsically related to the Stranger, as her name is very rarely said in these logs. The grimoire card bearing her name, as well as the ghost fragments bearing her name, are, practically speaking, some of the only concrete sources we have to work for at the moment. And so, theory on the Exo Stranger is hard to understand, and harder still to come by. The only point at which the Stranger might have re-emerged would be the discovery of an exotic and an ARG that occurred in Warmind, namely, the World Line Zero quest. Before explaining what this is, I need to emphasize something really important. The conclusions that we're going to all draw from the Worldline quest will likely lead us in a direction that may help us understand who the Exo Stranger is, but they do not confirm that identity. So yet again, I will endeavor to tell you all this story, but I want you to know it with the caveat that it may not contain any answers to our question as to who the Exo Stranger is. So with that said, even though there will be a compelling end result to this story, and there will be a name mentioned here that may indeed link to the Stranger, we cannot confirm it until we actually confront the Stranger and have a chance to ask her in person. We may in fact never know, and the Stranger's identity may simply be one of those enigmas where we have a single decent guess thanks to this, but no confirmed true answer. So with all that said, let's go ahead and try and straighten out this confusing story. Starting off with Worldline Zero, what is it? Well, Worldline Zero is an exotic sword that we acquired in Warmind. It is found by shooting these strange beacons around the Braytech Futurescape campus on Mars. These are actually nodes that were planted by one Elsie Bray and require specific weapon telemetry to activate. After acquiring all of these beacons, you can acquire the Worldline Zero and the five lost memory fragments that tell its story. Before we begin, important things to note are simply that there is a Vex core at the heart of the Worldline Zero, and that Clovis Bray has certain members, such as Willa Bray, that will not take anything as a reason why they shouldn't look to further science, morality included. Our story begins with some of the five lost memory fragments that can be acquired by shooting those nodes around the Braytech Futurescape campus, but I believe that in the midway point, we'll need to do a little explaining and add the lore tab of the Worldline Zero. I believe that the story told in these memory fragments follows the talented Clovis Bray engineer and Bray family member known as Elsie Bray. She and Anna were both talented persons of interest back in the Golden Age, Anna being her adopted little sister. And it's also worth noting that Elsie's particular speciality was in weapon systems and spacefaring ships. The first of these lost memory fragments reads as follows. 25 days until divergence. As an engineer, I wish I could bottle inspiration. You never know when it'll hit. For instance, this morning I was servicing some Hephaestus field units, test nodes that are meant to gauge weapon effectiveness in a variety of field conditions, and I had an idea. The nodes are mobile enough that they could be easily hidden, and reconfigured to need specific weapon data to activate. If someone is smart enough, they could easily arrange the nodes to serve as a locking mechanism, one that's hidden right in plain view. This entry explains what the hidden weapon nodes in the Futurescape are doing. They're acting as a locking mechanism that are hiding the world line zero from prying eyes, and this is indeed what happens. After shooting a certain number of them, you will actually unlock the world line zero. And those that would want to misuse it will hopefully be stopped by this system. The next entry hints at the creation of the world line zero and the acquisition of the Vex core at its center. 21 days until divergence. A brilliant classmate I met at the physics fellowship in Delhi took a job on Venus to continue her research. Twice a year we exchange encrypted transmissions to share ideas, for it's a silly notion to lay claim to shared human knowledge. Ishtar Academy materials are forbidden on Mars, but I avail myself of any opportunity to push myself to the next peak. If I can get my hands on a Vex core, there's no telling how far I can push Bray engineering. This is of course hinting to the idea that Elsie managed to acquire the Vex core from the Ishtar Collective. The question that might also be relevant to some of you is the question of whether Elsie Bray is referring to Maya Sundaresh, the infamous member of the Ishtar Academy team. But it's unclear given that there's no name given to this particular classmate of Elsie's, and the time of the Golden Age presents us with gleaming opportunities for students everywhere. It's not at all impossible that they could have studied at the same university or institution generally, but it's also the case to remember that there were flourishing research centers all over the system, and generally speaking, travel throughout the system was not as cumbersome as one might expect. Indeed, when it came to the Golden Age, one might also interpret the case that these researchers and these people who may have studied alongside each other may have studied in other places first, and might never even have crossed paths. The Golden Age was vast and had far more people than there were in the current timeline of Destiny, so keep an open mind on that one. The next entry talks about the possibilities of Vex technology, and how this Vex core could be used to effectively alter our timeline by simulating space and time in real time next to our own timeline. Simulations, they're gonna confuse you. Anyway, it reads as follows. 12 days until divergence. Jumping into an Einstein-Rosen bridge to travel in time has long been regarded as fantasy by serious physicists. But what if there existed a computer so powerful it could indistinguishably simulate an entire alternate timeline? Based on my early research, this is a possibility of Vex technology. The key question would be whether one could take knowledge from a simulated timeline and alter the original. One step at a time, though. I think it's at this point that we need to start explaining what a world line is as opposed to a timeline, because yeah, it's about to become relevant. A world line is effectively a little bit like a path that a specific object takes through space-time. Not space, not time, but space-time. To best explain it, imagining a pair of cars traveling along the same route, traveling the same distance. Let's say for the sake of being arbitrary, it's a mile. One car completes this journey in 2 minutes and the other in 4 minutes. Both cars are following the same path, so their coordinates through space are the same. But they are taking a different amount of time to reach those end coordinates, and so they take a different amount of time, and as a result, they have different world lines. What differs is not the destination they end up at, but the amount of time that it takes to get there, and as a result, their world line, which is the combination of space and time for this specific object, is different for the two cars. This is a really basic understanding of world lines at best, so please refer to a real physicist. I'm guessing, if I really had to suggest one, go ahead and ask Shingley. Actually, don't ask Shingley, I'm sure he would not want to be bombarded with messages. All that aside, World Line Zero's lore tab is what we're going to read next, and hopefully that understanding of what a world line is, in other words, an object and its trajectory through space-time, is going to be relevant here. This lore tab for Worldline Zero indicates the involvement of Willa Bray in the story. Willa Bray was the overlord of the Siva Project, and notably had next to no problems with anything immoral happening in the name of progress in that project too, and so you can imagine that Elsie might have been spooked by an email from her. In fact, she logged into her terminal at Clovis Bray, and this is what happened. The transcript reads as follows. Domain, Clovis Bray Corporation, Mars. User, Elsie Bray. Password. Connecting to Bray Network. You are now logged in. Clovis Bray Mail, Inbox. You have one new message from Willa Bray. Clovis Bray Mail, Red, 1. El, congrats on your success! I saw the latest readings. This will be huge. I did have some thoughts on potential applications of your research. Let's have a chat. Dinner will be on me. Clovis Bray, Mail. Delete all. Message has been removed. CD, directory changed to root. Sudo RMRF. Sudo enter password for super user. Are you sure? Deleting 1,452,832 files. Error, one file, Hephaestus Index 005, could not be deleted. 1,452,831 files successfully deleted. Log out. Fatal. No shell. Permission denied. The reasons behind Elsie being sought out by Willa aren't entirely clear. Maybe it was simply because the Vex Corps was incorporated into the project that Elsie was working on, and that was against Clovis Bray's regulations. Maybe it was because of some other reason, but Elsie clearly didn't trust Willa with her work, and it appears from later files that Willa may have been attempting to get her hands on the Worldline Zero. Elsie managed to delete all but one file, Hephaestus Index 005, which I presume must have been related to the Worldline Zero, seeing as in the next memory fragment, Elsie is trying to hide data. Willa wanted to find the weapon, and Elsie was not going to let her have it. 3 days until divergence. If I'm gone, that means something terrible has happened to me. I've wiped all traces of my research, but Willa has security scouring the facility for me. She wants to take the weapon I've created, and at this point, it's impossible to take it off-world. It's way too dangerous to fall into wrong hands, so my only choice is to hide it. The old storage caches in Core Terminus and Olympus Descent are now linked to the Hephaestus test network. The final entry reveals something remarkable about Elsie's reasons for hiding the weapon she created. She was wishing for us to find it. It reads as follows. 2 days until divergence. I'm out of time. All I've got to hold on to is the hope that I've moved enough of my tech into the vaults, and that the visions of the future I've seen are accurate. That somehow divorced from time and space, my words find you. Please, tell Anna I'm sorry, and that I never wanted her to be dragged into this. You were smart enough to break my code, so I'll put my trust in you to use what I've created to make things right. One day, this will all make sense. I promise. This message is clearly directed at us, and it indicates that Elsie saw a future that was dark and required changing. This may have been our future or some future where the darkness won. It's at this point that we can sort of speculate about how Elsie saw the dark future. And in my mind, the only real possibility is that she was able to use the Vex Corps' ability to simulate a perfect mathematical copy of our present and work it forward into the future. In that future, it's possible that Elsie saw the darkness, and as a result, she may well be leaving the sword here for us so that we can change the future, even slightly. And it's at this point where we need to really speculate how Worldline Zero works. It's a sword, obviously. But I think that the idea of its Tesseract perk comes from the fact that it may have a Vex Corps at its heart, the very same Vex Corps mentioned in the story. This is not only why you see the word Tesseract being used, which is a shadow cast by a four-dimensional object, keeping in mind that time would be our fourth dimension, making this a world line, but also it gives us the ability to slightly alter our timeline by altering the world line of this particular object and anything it interacts with. This means that we may see time slowly change as we use this weapon and its Tesseract ability, maybe by defeating minions of the darkness that otherwise would have stood or would have been able to do more malice for more time, And as a result, maybe by using the World Line Zero, Elsie Bray believed that we could slowly change the future bit by bit, shifting and altering our timeline by using the World Line to make it better and to fight back darkness. And this would have been where the story of the World Line Zero ended, and it would have merely been a story about Elsie Bray. But then, we found something different. There was a small glyph found on the side of Rasputin's chamber, and then an ARG spawned from it. Ultimately, it led to a message that I'll now read. Thank you for taking the time to piece together this message, friend. The time of our final conflict is drawing closer, and you and Anna have an important role to play in the events to come. So watch over her, Guardian. I would have no life without Anna or the Exo program. I regret that we have become strangers, but we each have a path that we must walk. And, ironically, there never seems to be enough time. Tell her, Rasputin's first attempt was in the right location at the wrong moment. Look here. 43.549573 73.544868 E. The message is clearly from Elsie, and it confirms a few important things. Firstly, that she became an Exo, and that Anna might have helped her do it. Secondly, that she has been watching for the time when our final conflict will draw near, and that it is indeed close. Thirdly, the mention of the fact that she regrets that her and Anna have become strangers. A very choice use of language, but it could also be a reference to the fact that Anna has lost her memories, given that now she's a Guardian. The same use of the stranger language also appears in the Anseris Overdrive Sparrow from Warmind, where Elsie states that she's a stranger to her own nature. The Eon Drive Sparrow is an updated version of that Sparrow, which has not necessarily been degraded by the tests of time, but is in fact the same Sparrow, and was again potentially worked on by Elsie Bray in her youth. All of this also seems to indicate that Elsie, after having disappeared, began to time travel. The other piece of evidence, apart from the fact that Elsie is now time traveling and is an Exo, is that Anna Bray and the Exo Stranger share a symbol on their armor, which thus far has not been defined to mean anything, but consists of a pair of semicircles separated by space and a line. It is worth noting that this is not the only place this appears, and it's not the only character that it appears on, but regardless, the connection at the time stirred people's minds. Now, does all of this mean that Elsie Bray is the Exo Stranger? It's certainly a possibility, but it's not confirmed. The language offers very heavy hints towards it, and even gives us a really contextually unique situation that leads us to think that if Elsie isn't the Stranger, then it's incredible that there are now two female time-traveling Exos. With all of that said, it is once again important to state that there is no confirmation of this truly. It is at best theory based on what we have learned from Elsie Bray's records. Elsie Bray might well be the Exo Stranger, but we'll need to talk to her about it in Beyond Light, or at very least to hear some kind of sideline of dialogue about it from her in order to truly know if she is indeed Elsie. She may well have been watching us this whole time, and if that is the case, then Elsie is knowledgeable of many things, different timelines in which the darkness may have won, different points at which in the Golden Age she was able to see different pieces of Vex technology being used, and of course, she has been privy to seeing us fight all this time. There is one final piece of information that I think needs to be discussed, and it comes from the Nine. We're going to start with it by looking into the invitations of the Nine. And by the way, it has to be said, if you've not done these and you're looking for content to keep you going that's relevant to the story of the current season, these are really worth doing. They reveal a lot about the Nine, the Darkness, and other topics that are related to them. Of interest are the first and last invitations, which both make reference to three figures that have, as the Nine would put it, transcended their design. Take a listen to this first invitation.
We stand at the precipice of history. What you do here changes the cosmic balance forever. You have made allies of dangerous beings, gods and god pretenders. How long before your company involves you in something you can't come back from? Those I serve have so much to learn from you. You are their greatest curiosity. the agent on whom all fates converge. The Dredgen presents a special prize to the Nine. He is an anomaly, an elemental balance, a grand experiment. We remember his trial.
It's about time someone taught you respect, little man.
Ha! Someone like you? I know you all keep tabs on me.
Yeah. You've been straying. You don't even use his name no more.
Well, that's why I'm still breathing, brother. Gambit is a chance at salvation. Take it.
Always so afraid Shin would get you. Sorry, old friend.
Behind you. Anymore. It's Drifter now.
You have proven yourself worthy. Accept this gift from the knife.
A gift? What gift?
Only two others have transcended their design. The first, an hourglass counting down with infinite patience. The second, a forgotten blade sharpened anew. And now, the Dredgen. Visit us again. We wish for you to understand what we understand. For now, it is my purpose to speak to you and you alone. But only if you remain worthy.
The vision that the Nine use as a reference for the Drifter transcending his design is a vision of him using a mote of dark to defeat a Dredgen of the Shadows of Yore that was threatening him aboard his ship, the Derelict. This is an example of the Drifter, a Lightbearer who has the power of the light intrinsically, using the power of darkness to overcome his foes, thus transcending his design. There are only two others according to the Emissary who have also managed to do this. They are listed as an hourglass counting down with infinite patience, and a forgotten blade sharpened anew. It has been long speculated that these figures who accompany the Dredgen were Mara Sov and Eris Morn respectively, but the final entry of the invitations cast doubt onto one of those possibilities, namely Mara Sov. Take a listen.
We have another truth to share with you. The Dredgen should have told you himself. But, as always, fear keeps him from true potential. Please, open your mind.
Might just pull this scam off. And when the time comes, we'll finally be in the clear.
Attention is required elsewhere.
All right. Thanks for the memories, you lunatic. Anything else I can do for you?
You're already doing it. Keep playing the game. The night falls. Out there on the edge, your fate is a war unseen amid ruined fleets. Two women, feared, untrusted, forever at arm's length. Here at home, your fate is a coin in the hand of a liar. One man, afraid, untrustworthy, forever grasping. You must reckon with yourself. Can you see the path ahead? Do you know the shape of your tribe?
In this final invitation, the emissary talks of two women, feared, untrusted, and forever at arm's length. This is not the description you would assign to Mara Sov. She was loved and respected by the Awoken, and in spite of the wrath that she could inspire, she was very much trusted by her people. The Exo Stranger, on the other hand, was seen as nothing more than myth, was indeed supposed to come alongside aspects of great calamity and moments of disaster, and was always at arm's length, unable to talk to us. Luke Smith, in the interview that he had with Mark Noseworthy for the Destiny 2 Beyond Light reveal, confirmed that the Exo Stranger was not forged in light once again, and it's at this point that he also points out that maybe this could be something to do with the darkness, simply by making that statement. And, of course, there is something else to consider. If there are three that transcended their design and were able to use darkness, would it not make some sense that they were able to meet up at some point and stand together as a trio, such as, I don't know, say, the trailer for Beyond Light, where the Drifter, Eris Morn, and the Exo Stranger meet on the surface of Europa. Three who have transcended their design, and one, namely you, who will eventually follow in their footsteps. We know that we'll acquire dark powers in Beyond Light, and so suddenly, transcending the design seems to make a lot more sense in this context. Perhaps it is indeed the Exo Stranger that the Nine were referring to. The words of the Nine are, of course, cryptic, and it's hard to confirm the last part until we know more, but what isn't cryptic is the warning uttered by the Stranger in the Beyond Light gameplay trailer. This will be the last thing that we will have as evidence, so take a listen.
Where I come from, the Darkness won. I have witnessed this firsthand. I refuse to let it happen again. It's time the truth presented itself to you. Darkness resides within, beckoning you. This is a truth we cannot hide from, and so we must embrace it.
In order to prevent the dark future that may well be coming for all of us, we may have to use the powers of darkness to defeat whatever evils we are soon to confront. This is the warning of the Stranger. The Stranger was not forged in light, but where your path and hers cross, ground could break. And hopefully this time, calamity may yet be averted. Although even this is uncertain. Oh, and one more thing that's uncertain? No, I don't know what the damn space fish is. Thank you very much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, go ahead and leave a like. This was a pretty long one, but hopefully this has been a decent examination of the story of the Exo Stranger, as well as a look into the World 9-0 quest, which might be related to her. With all of that said, if you did enjoy and you want more Destiny lore content like this, as well as lore content from other games, go ahead and hit the subscribe button and the bell next to subscribe. If you have your own thoughts down below, the comments section is open, so you can go ahead and leave them there. But for now, know that, as always, your viewership is quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been My Name is Bife. Purodasia ad astra. I'll see you, Starside.